glean in the fields behind the harvesters. As it turned out, she found herself working in a field belonging to Boaz, who was from the clan of Elimelech. Just when Boaz arrived from Bethlehem and greeted the harvesters, The Lord be with you. The Lord bless you, they called back. Boaz asked the foreman of his harvesters, whose young woman is that? The foreman replied, she is the Moabitess who came back from Moab with Naomi. She said, please let me glean and gather among the sheaves behind the harvesters. She went into the field and has worked steadily from morning till now, except for a short rest in the shelter. So Boaz said to Ruth, my daughter, listen to me. Don't go and glean in another field, and don't go away from here. Stay here with my servant girls. Watch the field where the men are harvesting, and follow along after the girls. I have told the men not to touch you, and whenever you are thirsty, go and get a drink from the water jars the men have filled. At this, she bowed down with her face to the ground. She exclaimed, why have I found such favor in your eyes that you notice me, a foreigner? Boaz replied, I have been told all about you, what you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband. Now you left your father and mother and your homeland and came to live with the people you did not know before. May the Lord repay you for what you have done. May you be richly rewarded by the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings you have come to take refuge. May I continue to find favor in your eyes, my Lord, she said. You have given me comfort and have spoken kindly to your servant, though I do not have the standing of one of your servant girls. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading this morning. If you've read the book of Ruth, you will know the amazing story that came out of that. You will know that Jesus is part of that birth order as well. So we needed Ruth to go with Naomi in order for Jesus to be born where he was. So it's good to be in the house of God together. We make the choice to come, and so we have. Today we're looking at week 3 of our sermon series. We did have a break in the middle there because it was Anzac Day last week. So we're up to week 3 in our sermon series about telling our story. When we look at our lives, we pick and choose the things that we're going to tell people. It's not generally the rule that I would run up to one of you and say, oh, I did the worst thing today and I should be in jail. That's not going to happen, ever. And I'm also not going to do something jail-worthy, but you get the point. We don't normally pick the worst parts to tell people. We normally pick the good stuff, the shiny stuff, the stuff that reflects us in a great light. Stories, they come from decisions that we've made, both good and bad. But as I said, we don't generally tell the bad. But if we do need to tell the bad, we kind of tell it gently or smoothly. The decisions we make today will determine what story we get to tell tomorrow. So if somebody asks me, how was your weekend, Debbie? I'm not going to say I did no housework and I let the dog stay inside. But I spent the weekend relaxing, crocheting and cuddling my dog. All good things. I did put the dog outside, actually. The reality of life is that in every course that we take, we will encounter an obstacle and a challenge, and we must get through it or over it or around it somehow. We are not, just because we are Christians, we are God followers, we are not exempt from challenges and obstacles. They present to us the same as they present to everybody. So maybe one of these obstacles is your job. Maybe it's you're in a job that you cannot stand one more day, but you're going to go anyway. Maybe it's a relationship that's gone sour and you don't know if it's worth keeping that relationship. Maybe it's a dream or a vision that you've had for your life. Something you're trying to accomplish and you start wondering if it's ever going to happen. then you need to decide if it's worth staying the course or giving up, quitting it entirely. It's like dieting. I quit that sucker entirely. That's ridiculous. I'm not doing that. And then I'll do it again. Nope, not doing that, and I quit. And then I give it another shot. Dieting is probably the easiest one to pick on, isn't it? Beyond a shadow of a doubt, I would say we need to acknowledge that there are times that you need to walk away. You need to end things. And you need to know that that is okay. It's not okay to stay the course of violence and abuse in your life. That's not okay. We would never say to somebody, oh, just hang in there, it'll get better. We don't know that it will get better. Sometimes you've got to end things. I ended a friendship once, and I had to, and I still feel good about that. I was not okay in that relationship, in that friendship. And it's over. And I feel, it's been a long time now, I felt released and better. Sometimes you have to walk away. Sometimes God is calling you to end things. And then sometimes he's actually calling you to stay with it. Stick it out, because it'll be worth it. There are times when you need to let one chapter finish so that the other chapter can start. It's like reading the first chapter of a book over and over and over and over. You will never know what else happened in that story if you keep reading the first chapter over and over. Keep living the same mistake over and over without ending it and starting something new. You will never move forward. So how do we live a story worth telling? I'm just going to look up. I thought I had, but I've opened the wrong book. Hebrews. I always get Hebrews a bit lost in the back here. Nope. Left-handed turning, swap hands. I'm very nervous today. Here we go. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2 says to us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who for the sake of the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, disregarding its shame, and has taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of God. Jesus, our perfecter, our author of our lives, disregarding the pain of the cross. We've just had Easter. I can't disregard the pain of the cross. I find Easter incredibly overwhelming. But Jesus, disregarding the shame of the cross, the pain he endured, in order to get the joy that he received at the right hand of his Father, he stayed the course. He knew what was going to happen. He knew it was going to be painful and ugly. He stayed the course and he was rewarded. Let's fix our eyes on Jesus, not fix our eyes on the situation. Situations will always be. Let's not fix our eyes on random options, but instead fix our eyes, thoughts and minds on Jesus. He will tell you, show you when something has to end and a new thing has to start. And it's not going to be, oh, here's a letter for you, Jesus said. It's not going to be like that. It'll be the stirring of your heart. In this sermon, in this sermon series of telling our story, we're looking at four things. Today I'm doing three, but first week, if you remember, we decided to start disciplines that help us live the story God wants us to live. In week two, we talked about deciding to stop anything that hinders us from living the story God wants us to tell. Today, we're looking at the discipline of staying when it's easier to go. And next week, Wes will talk about looking. Oh, I think it's Wes. It might be me again. We'll look at going when it's easier to stay. I know it sounds like I just said the same thing twice, but today is staying when it's easier to go. Next week is going when it's easier to stay. But today, let's talk about that. When it's easier to stay rather than walk away. Maybe you're facing a decision like that now. Maybe you have faced a decision like that in your life. I have. It's not an easy road to take. Do we stay the course or do we walk away? How many times has that been presented to you as an option? How many times have you wanted that to be the option? Well, fine, I'll just go. I'll just go. That's fine, I'll just go. You might not want to go. Maybe just having a little, I'll just go, fine, I'll go tantrum, instead of seeking out God. It's okay to take a breath, to take a moment. It's okay to rest in God. No decisions have to be rushed. It's never good to rush God. If you haven't worked that out, I have. It is never a good thing to rush the decisions of God. As we read Ruth this morning, a great example for us is Naomi and her two daughters-in-law. Naomi was the mother-in-law, and Ruth and Orpah were the daughters-in-law. When all three women became widowed, this was a massive catastrophe. Three widows, no income earners. This was never going to be great for them. They were now destitute and had to make a plan. So Naomi thought best thing to do, send the girls home, back to their people so that they could be at least looked after by brothers or fathers until they remarried, which would be the normal course of events for those situations back then. Ruth knew this was the easiest way forward. She would go back to her family. And, sorry, I thought that was my dog because he looks exactly like that. And they would go back to theirs. Naomi tried to talk her out of it. Ruth wanted to stay. Naomi tried to talk her out of it. And then she said these words, "Your people will be my people, and your God will be my God." Naomi saw through the actions of her mother-in-law, the one true God, and made that decision. That was the right decision for her. Orpah made the decision to go home and be with her family. That was the right decision for her. Naomi wanted her daughters-in-law to both go home for their own security. They would be able to remarry, and they would be secure. It takes a massive amount of prayer, thinking, and planning to do what Ruth has done. The story of Ruth gets to tell of the choice she makes. The choice she made was spread around. Everybody was talking about this woman who came home with Naomi. This woman who gave up her family, who gave up her security to support Naomi. Everyone was talking about it. Everyone was telling her story for her. She didn't have to do it. And this story is the story that stirred Boaz's heart to have compassion on her. He didn't have to. Wealthy man, landowner, servants, hired men, slaves most likely. He had everything. He didn't have to have compassion on this woman. Through her careful planning, her careful decision making, her whole life was changed. Because she decided to stay when it would have been easier to go. Much easier to go. All of us at some point have come to a crossroad, or we will come to a crossroad, where we are going to have to make a choice. So our decision we make is going to be asking ourselves, What does God want me to want? What does he want me to want? Not just what does he want me to do or what path does he want me to take. What does he want me to want? You should be able to answer that if you have a close look at your life. In the light of what God wants you to want, here is an application question. Where does God want you to stay? Where does God want you to stay on the course so that you can live the story that God wants you to tell? Let me tell you a story. We moved to one of our appointments when the kids were still in nappies. And on our first Sunday, we literally doubled the size of the core. This was heartbreaking for me. I agreed to go, but this outcome was unacceptable. What was I supposed to do with four people? A very elderly man, a middle-aged couple, and a single woman. I became very, very angry. And the anger turned into loneliness because I was very angry. And I wanted to return to where I had come from. Busy church, thriving youth ministry, supportive friends, and my family nearby. Why would I stay? I didn't want to stay. I hated how I had let my circumstances dictate my feelings. I was 33 when I moved there, so still a bit of growing up to do. It was easier to go, much easier to go. So I requested to Wes that we ask to be moved or we quit. Pretty much like that as well. It was definitely harder to stay than leave. But stay we did. Then we started to do things. So you arrive in January, things don't actually kick off until February. 20 people in my home league, none of which attended my core, obviously. The maths just tells you that. The family store was full of volunteers, one of which came to my church. Interesting life. One night I couldn't sleep, so I made my way to the lounge room to find out Wes couldn't sleep. When I got up, I didn't notice he wasn't there. I just got up. We had a long discussion about church, what we were going to do. And we came to the conclusion to get out of God's way. We realized that we'd been standing in God's way. Now, we'd been at this appointment about 12 months or so when we came to this conversation. We got to bed that morning at 4:30 in the morning, and lovely Logie wakes up at 6:30 every day. So up he was and so was I, but refreshed, surprisingly, 2 hours sleep. But because we'd made a decision to stay and to give God all the control, we stayed and church turned around. We had 30 kids at Kids Church, which was on Thursdays, and about the same amount of adults on a Sunday. How that happened is God's doing. It's nothing to do with me, nothing to do with Wes. We stayed, although it was hard. We had beautiful neighbours and other churches included us in their events and activities. And it turned out fine. I don't know how things would have turned out if I had really forced the issue and got moved. But this was how it was meant to be. It is not always the right thing to leave just because something gets difficult. It's not always the right thing to leave. But you get to choose your story. You get to decide the outcome. Do you remember those novels where you used to read it and get to the end of the page and it would say, if you want to go down the tunnel, turn the page. If you'd like to run back to the forest, go to page 7. It's not exactly like that, but God is not going to puppet control you. He will guide and he will nurture. But how things turn out for you is up to you. Perhaps you've been upset at work, as I was with my appointment that I was not impressed with. Or you've had your feelings hurt at church and decided you've had enough, so you're leaving. I also did that one time. I wasn't an officer at the time, but I had had enough. Instead of leaving and throwing in the towel, how about asking God what he wants you to want? He's not going to judge you. He's not going to turn his back on you. He is never going to leave you just because you don't make a right choice. It's your choice. And whatever choice you make, however you choose to stay or go, he will still be there. He will still love, guide, and protect. But ultimately, the choice is ours. So what story do we want to tell? How do we want our journey to go forward? Every single day I go into my office and it's a different journey. Because I'm an officer, no 2 days are ever the same. A little bit of predictability wouldn't actually kill me. But no 2 days are ever the same. You can plan everything and then boom, something will happen. Something always happens. Every week there's something else. So now I kind of make a plan and I just kind of leave it open to interpretation by God. Whatever he wants, I want whatever he wants me to want. And he wants my life to be fulfilled. He wants me to feel like I am on the right path. There is no reason for us to wander around in the dark when we have a God who will shine the light for us. As the team come to play for us, take the opportunity to ask God what he wants you to want. Let him refill your heart with the desires that perhaps you've pushed aside because life gets complicated and confusing. Life is difficult, and I'm never going to deny that. It certainly does. But sometimes the right decision is to stay the course until such a time comes that he tells you it's time to go. Thanks, Neil.
Sing up.
You stood before creation, eternity in your hand. You spoke the earth into motion, my soul now. Stood before my failure and carried the cross for my shame. My sin weighed upon your shoulders, my soul now to stand. So what can I say? After this heart of mine, completely to you, so I'll walk upon salvation, your spirit alive in me, my life duty.
Into this new week, I just pray for blessings to be poured out in our community, for opportunities to come our way for us to speak your name, and that we might find ourselves ever desiring to be closer to you, and may our hearts want what you want for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated. Are there announcements this morning? Let's have a look. No? There might be nothing happening, except that there is. So, next week is Mother's Day. Yay. Happy day. Mother's Day will still have program running. So, it's also the launch of Kids Church next week. So, if you have a child connected to here, or if you know children that want to come to Kids Church, it's starting next week. Kathy, time? 8:30. Quarter to nine it will start. And Amy is in charge of rostering, so there'll be people in charge of Kids Church every week, and we're starting a new Kids Church called The Link Show. So they're going to do some interaction with iPads. So it's internet church for kids, which is very cool. And then we take them off the internet and we do normal things with them as well. So we're mixing it all up and bringing two worlds together, and the kids will have a great time. The guy who's in charge of it is called Buckle. This is an Australian program and he lives on the Gold Coast. And so hopefully one day we're going to get Buckle to come out here and see the kids. So we look forward to launching Kids Church next Sunday. Also, Space to Call Home is on next Sunday, even though it's Mother's Day. It's still on. Announcements, I can't think. Our Coffee and Cake Night is also Friday night this week coming. So if you are interested in Coffee and Cake Night, it is here in the hall. Our guest speaker is Bronwyn Barkmeyer. I've asked her to come and be our guest speaker because our theme for Coffee and Cake Night this year is Make It Happen, and it is our spiritual journey. Make our spiritual journey happen through And we've got different guest speakers, and she's going to come and talk to us about how her and her husband ran the outreach service. So it's making it happen through our communities. So their church service was right in their community. They did so many great things. I've asked her to come and just talk to us about that, and so we can get a little glimpse into how they did their community church. And so we look forward to that. Everyone is welcome to that. So that's this Friday night coming, 7 till roughly 9, with Bronwyn as our guest speaker. She doesn't work there anymore. She is in DHQ now, and this is her first year being in the DHQ appointment. So I don't know if she's loving that or not. She might be. But we look forward to having Bronwyn out here. Anything else happening? Not that we can think of. Anyone else can think of anything happening? No. Silver Threads. Silver Threads is this Wednesday, and we're having movie day. So if you're going to come along to Silver Threads, we're going to be in this room. 10:30, we're going to start The War Room. So if you've seen The War Room, you'll know that it is a fantastic movie. If you haven't seen The War Room and you want to come watch it, we're going to be in here. I will provide popcorn and a vacuum cleaner. So we look forward to Silver Threads, and so it's this Wednesday at 10:30. That's it from me. We're going to have our final song together, and I don't have a meeting lead anymore, so let's have a look at it. Lord, I lift your name on high. Evan's favourite, so let's be upstanding to sing together. I pray that as you go into this week, you will feel truly surrounded and encamped by His Holy Spirit, that you will know His peace, and that you will take that peace into all your conversations and be a blessing to others. Amen. Now, Lisa's on her own out there with the cup of tea, so be kind, and let's have a cup of tea together.